Good morning, students. Today our topic is cascading style sheet CSS, and this is CSS part 2. In our previous lecture we already discussed some key points regarding to CSS and a simple program based on CSS. So let us take a quick revision for all these terms, and then after we'll discuss some new topics related to CSS. So first of all, what is CSS? Basically, CSS stands for cascading style sheets, and CSS is a language that describes the style of a HTML document. And CSS describes how HTML elements should be displayed. And CSS handles the look and feel part of the web page. So basically, we can say that CSS is used for the look and feel part of a web page. CSS handles the look and feel part of the web page. And CSS describes how HTML elements should be displayed. So if you want to make your HTML web page some more beautiful, then you can use CSS. And if you attach an external CSS file, then the extension of the CSS file is .css. These are some key points related to CSS. Now, let us see the program based on CSS. So, using CSS, you can control the color of the text, style of the font, spacing between the paragraphs, how columns are sized and laid out, and what background images are colored or used. So, this type of setting we can change very easily. So you can easily see that there is a program and that is written in HTML, but in this program you can see that a style tag is used, and within the style tag we define basically the CSS property here. So color of the body is yellow, so we can easily see that we give background dash color, that is an attribute after that colons sign, and then yellow is the name of the color. Then same thing is used for H1 heading tag, where color is red and text align is center. When we use a style tag, that means we use a CSS. So that type of CSS is called the internal CSS, in which within the style tag, we can see that the style element, we define the different attribute value combination for different tags. In this case, we define it for body tag, H, heading tag, and paragraph tag. And the attribute that are used are background color, background dash color, text dash color, and font dash size. So you can easily see that when we talk about the attributes of CSS, then their names are separated by when there is a combination of two words, then these two words are separated by a dash sign in an attribute. And after that name of the attribute, we just define colon sign after that value of that attribute, and after that semicolon sign is mandatory. To put semicolon sign is mandatory. So this is a type of internal CSS here. Now you can easily see the output, in which your background color is yellow, and heading color you can see that it is red, and text alignment is also by default is left, but when we assign a text align then center will be there. So this is the output, which is already, this program is already discussed in our previous lecture. So I just give a quick revision for that term. Now, this is a syntax of CSS. You must remember it. I think very easy to learn. So first of all, selector is any tag of HTML. Then within the curly brackets, you can define the property value combination separated by a colon sign, and after that put semicolon. So there are two properties here, color and font size, and color is blue and font size is 12 pixel for a tag that is a selector H1. So H1 is a selector. It means we apply a property on tag H1. Now there is another example. Here in this case, selector is P. The property is color and text align. Values are red and center. Now CSS comment. We always define CSS comment in the sign of slash star. So whatever we put within the slash star and star slash is basically work as a comment here. Then CSS selector. So we can make a select on the, we can use selector in three different ways. First of all, just give the name of the selector. Second case, use ID selector. In case of ID selector, we always give a ID, and ID always start with a hash sign. You can easily see that, hash para 1. So the ID selector use the ID attribute of HTML element. Now you can easily see the diagram, hash para 1. Basically in this we use the ID selector. And third is class selector. Class selector is always mentioned with a dot operator. After dot operator we define the name of the class. In this case you can see that dot center is a class selector. So all the tags related to that class are basically, and all the elements related to that class basically apply the setting of that selector, that class selector. And if you want to apply the setting for a particular object of that class, that name should be mentioned. In this case you can see that p dot class name, whatever is the class name, then the setting of that class will apply on p tag only. That means text align should be center and color should be red only on the paragraph. Center is the name of the class here. You can easily see in this program here. So here h1 and p, there are the two tags of class center, but settings are applied only the paragraph p. Then there is another point that an element, a tag may be part of more than one class. Suppose there are two class, center and large, then both type of setting will be applied. So center and large class, whatever we have the property, that property should be applied to that element. Now all these topics are already discussed in our previous lecture. Now let us talk about the universal selector, which is not discussed in a previous class or previous video. So the universal selector is basically marked with a asterisk sign, and it select all HTML elements on the page. So if you want to apply the setting for all HTML element, then you just mark star sign in case of selector. That setting will be applied to the all elements. Okay, that means here you can easily see that in the diagram, text aligns is center and color is blue. That means all the elements should follow text alignment center and color blue. So that's why it is called the universal selector, because it applies on all of the text or on all of the text of HTML web page. So let us see program of this universal selector. This will give you a clear idea. CSS universal selector. And why this is called universal? Because it applies setting to all the HTML elements defined in the program. Now I just discuss here a simple example which gives you a clear idea how universal selector works. So that is a main code. In this you can see that in place of a selector we just mark a star sign here, and text is aligned and center, text align is center and color is blue. That is there is a program here. You can easily see that within the style element, you can easily see that we apply a universal selector. So different tags are there. You can easily see h1 and p, this heading tag and paragraph tag. So this setting means text align and color will be applied to both the element h1 and p after execution of this program. So that is the main purpose of using a universal selector, and that's why it is also that's why it is called the universal selector, because it applies the setting of CSS to all the HTML elements. So for this, just use a star sign in place of selector. So it will apply the setting, CSS setting for all elements of our HTML program. And in this example, there are two elements, H1 and P, H1 for heading and P for paragraph. So after the execution of that program, heading hello world will be text aligned, will be center aligned and of color blue. Same for paragraph tag. And you can also see here that ID is used for another paragraph, but instead of using the ID, universal selector works for this paragraph also. So now you can see the output. All headings and paragraphs are center aligned and are of blue color because universal selector is there. Even there is an ID selector, but since the universal selector is there, so all text related to heading and paragraph are center aligned and are of blue color. That is the main use of universal selector. Next is grouping selector. First of all, let us see what is the need of grouping a selector. There are different selectors and it may be possible that the same setting is there for different selectors, means same property value combination is there for different selectors. Then we don't need to write different property value combination for each and every selector, because property value combination is same for all selectors. You can easily see that in case of H1, text align is center and color is red. In case of H2, text align is also center and color is also red. In case of paragraph selector, text align is center and color is red. So we just write 3 times here the property value combination, and it looks very odd. Look very odd. So instead of writing it again and again, we just write it a single time. So that is called the grouping of selector. And how could this possible? Let us see. So here you can easily see that the statement is in here is that it will be better to group the selector to minimize the code. So basically it is used to minimize the code. Grouping of selector is used to minimize the code and to group selectors, separate each selector with a comma. So we just write H1, comma H2, comma P, and then after curly braces, we can write property value combination. You can see here, this way. So using this way, we are able to minimize our code, and that is a main advantage of grouping of selectors. Now text align is equal to text align is center and color is red for all these 3 selector H1, H2 and paragraph. Now the concept of selector is over. So let us take a quick revision of all the types of selector. We use class selector. So class selector is basically used to select all elements with class, and example is there dot intro. Intro is the name of the class. So the elements which belongs to, or we can say that the selector which belongs to the class intro have same property value combination. Then ID must be start with a hash sign. In this case you can see that ID is equal to first name is the ID, then star is universal selector. Then element, you can apply property for a single element also. And second is grouping of, last one is grouping of selector. We can apply the same setting for different selectors. In the last case, you can see that the DIB and P are the 2 selectors names. So we just separate them by a comma sign. So these are the four different methods to apply a setting of a selector. When we talk about the setting, it means the property value combination. And always remember that property value combination must be separated by a colon sign, and after each and every property value combination we must mark a semicolon sign, even if there are a single property value combination. Now our next topic is how to add CSS. Here we apply CSS file, and the example which we discussed in this video is internal CSS, but we also are able to apply CSS setting in two more different ways. These are external CSS and inline CSS. And the program which we discussed earlier are basically the example of internal CSS, in which we use a style element. So first of all, let us talk about external CSS. As the name suggests, with an external style sheet, you can change the look of an entire website by changing just one file. Second thing is, each HTML page must include a reference to the external style sheet while inside the link element inside the head section. So in external CSS, as the name suggests, there is basically a separate CSS file, and that CSS file is attached to the HTML web page in link section. So there is a small example here which gives you a clear idea about this. You can see that HTML tag, after that head, and after that within head tag there is a tag name used or element. There is a tag name used link, and link with three attributes: rel, style sheet, type text / css, and href. Difference here is mystyle.css. First of all, let us talk about href. So name of the CSS file is mystyle.css, and you can make a mystyle.css separate file in a notepad, but remember that give the extension .css. So mystyle is the name of CSS file, and then type is another attribute. So we just mentioned text of CSS, so it indicates that it is a CSS file or is a text file. And then rel should be style sheet, so value of the rel is style sheet. And these all attributes are defined in link tag. And here, what is the meaning of rel? Rel stands for relationship. So three different attributes: rel means relationship, type, and href should be there in case of external CSS. And these all are defined within link tag. In case of external CSS, a separate CSS file is there, and we can write a program of CSS in a notepad file simply, but always save them with a .css extension and keep that file in same folder in which the HTML file is there. So this is the main point. So in this way, you can attach an external CSS file to your web page. The .css file should be not contain any HTML tag. That is a very important point. An external style sheet can be written in any text editor. So most of the time we use Notepad, but you can use any text editor. But it must be saved with a .css extension. And the external CSS file should not contain any HTML tag. And here is an example you can see on the screen. The name of the file is mystyle.css. .css is there because this is a type of cascading style sheet file. So you can easily see that there is no tag. Only properties value combination are there for body h1. So you can write a program here in mystyle.css file. So on body selector, background color is light blue, and on H1 selector color is navy, and margin left is 20 pixel. So when you attach this external file to your HTML web page, then the settings apply to your HTML file. And this is an example of external CSS. And why this is an example of external CSS? Because we made a separate CSS file and link this separate CSS file to our HTML file. And one more important thing, do not add a space between the property value and the unit, such as margin left colon space 20 pixel. So the correct way is margin left colon 20 pixel. So no space should be there between the property value combination. That is another important thing. Now I think it is clear to all of you that how to add a external CSS file to your HTML web page. Next example is internal CSS. I think all of you are very much aware to the concept of internal CSS. Actually, what we discussed in our previous lecture is an example of internal CSS, and it is very easy to implement. Actually, this is implemented by using style element. So whatever you just write within the style element is a part of CSS file. So an internal style sheet may be used if one single HTML page has unique style, and the internal style is defined inside the style element inside the head section, and this is style element is used inside the head section. This is very important. So within head section you must use style element. Now you can easily see the program here, which gives you a clear idea of internal CSS. First of all, element program must start with the HTML and then after head, and within the head element you must mention style element, and you can easily see that style element is there, and the property or the code which is written in external file is there, that is body background color is linen, and h1 color margin color maroon, and margin left is equal to 40 pixel. So very simple to implement. For this purpose you must use style element, and the style element should be mentioned or should be a part of head element. That is the main point regarding to internal CSS, and all things are same. So you can easily see here that is a part of internal CSS. And that's why it is called the internal CSS, because the code is written within a HTML program. That's why it is called the internal CSS. And always must remember that style element must be used within head element. So these are the two basic example of external and internal. In external we make a separate file, but in internal we just write a code within style attribute which is mentioned within head element. Style element within head element. And the last case is inline CSS. So first of all, an inline CSS and inline style may be apply for a single element, and to use inline style, add the style attribute to the relevant element. The style attribute can contain any CSS properties. First of all, the first very important thing is that style is a name of element also, and style is a name of attribute also. So when we use style as an element, then this is an example of internal CSS, but we use style as an attribute in case of inline CSS. Now you can easily see the diagram, easily see the program here, in which we can easily see that body H1 and P, these are the two elements, and style attributes there in which style is defined. So this is an example of inline CSS. And why this is called inline CSS? Because we just marked the whole setting of a CSS in a single line. So use style attribute. When you use style as an attribute, then this is example of inline CSS. But we use style as an element, then this is example of internal CSS. And we just make a separate file, then this is make of CSS, then that is a case of external CSS. So style is used as an attribute, or it may be used as a element. So when we use a style as an attribute, then definitely it is an example of inline CSS. Now I think the difference between external, internal, and inline is now very much clear to all of you. As far as difference between external and internal CSS is concerned, the main difference is in external CSS we make a separate CSS file, but in internal CSS we make just write a code of CSS within a HTML web page. Now our second topic is multiple style sheets. So if some property have been defined for the same selector element in different style sheets, the value from last read style sheet will be used. In this example, you can see that there is an external style sheet and following style of H1 element, in which first of all H1 color is navy, and then in internal style sheet is also used, in which color is given as orange. Both these are the part of the same program, then what will be happens? So in this case, color will be range, or color will be orange, and because the color is orange, because as you can see, the last read style sheet will be used, that is written in the statement mentioned above. So H1 heading is of orange color. There is an example here. If the internal style sheet is defined after the link to the external style sheet, the H1 element will be orange. You can easily see here, this is an example. H heading is of orange color, because internal style sheet is just defined after the external style sheet. However, if the internal style sheet is defined before the link to the external style sheet, the H1 element will be, wait a minute, the H1 element will be navy. So it depends on totally on the order. If the internal style sheet is defined before the link to the external style sheet, the H1 element will be of navy color. Means what comes at the last, that property should be followed. Now that is the cascading order. So what style sheet will be used when there is more than one style specified for HTML element? So all the styles in a page will cascade into a new virtual style sheet by following rules, where number one has the highest priority. So number one priority is the inline style, number two priority is the external and the internal style sheet, and number three is browser default. So an inline style has highest priority and will be override external and internal style sheet and browser defaults. So if all the three types of style sheets are there, inline, external, internal, and browser default, so first priority is of internal, then second is of external, and third one is of browser. So it depends on the setting of the browser, although we can say that the browser defaults. So this is the default order. So this is all about our today's lecture. In our next lecture, we will discuss some properties related to color. So thanks for watching this video.